Good morning. Greetings from BMS College of Engineering, Bangalore. This is the fourth module on analog Butterworth filters. In the first module, we saw the salient features of Butterworth filters. And given n, we learned how to obtain the transfer function h of s. In the second module, we saw how to get n from the specifications of the filter. From the given frequency domain specifications, we learned to obtain n, and hence from n, we know to get h of s. In the third module, we saw how to implement the analog filter h of s using discrete components like the operational amplifier and the resistors and capacitors. This is what we have seen, and today we shall take up, we'll implement certain filters and just observe the output on a circuit simulator, and we are going to use the multisim live. Implementing our circuits. Of course, the full-fledged version is the multisim, but multisim live is has an open access, free access for anyone. So, as a first example, this is going to be take up the first order filter. Let's say we want to implement, because we are not going to take up moving from specifications to getting the order to transfer function. All this we have seen earlier. So now we will just take up and implement the direct implementation of the filter to meet the specification. So let us consider our aim was to implement a first order Butterworth filter, a low pass filter with a cutoff of fc given by 1 kilohertz. And let us say the DC gain is given as 3. This is our specifications. And now we need to implement this filter. So we know that the first order filter circuit is given in this manner, and we have the cutoff frequency fc given by 1 by 2 pi rc, and we also know the dc gain is given by rf plus rg by rc. Now let us get the values of our components to meet these given specifications. So what we are given is fc is given as 1 kilohertz. So fc is given as 1 kilohertz. Let us assume c is say 1 microfarad, and then we get r is equal to 1 by 2 pi fc c. So let us see what is the value of r when I take c as 1 microfarad and my cutoff frequency is say 1 kilohertz, and my fc is equal to 1 kilohertz, so it is 1000, and then my r becomes equal to 1 by 2 pi fcc, and that gives me 159 ohms. So this gives me 159 ohms, so I take it as a 160 ohm. This is my resistor. And similarly, I need to compute the resistors for giving me a DC gain. The DC gain is given as 3. The DC gain by from specifications is given as 3. And let us assume say RG is 1 kilo ohm. And then I will get RF, my feedback resistor, as 1. So feedback resistor becomes ADC minus RG, and that is going to be 3 minus 1, that is 2 kilo. So we now have our circuit as circuit with the values. My feedback resistor, I'm getting it as 2 kilo ohm. My RG, I fixed it at 1k, and then I got this as 2 for a gain of 3. I'm going to set my C as, I selected my C as 1 microfarad, and then I got the value of resistor as 160 ohm. So now let's try to implement the circuit and see the output. This is the circuit implemented on multisim to meet the same specification. The feedback resistor is 2 kilo ohm. the resistor to the ground is 1K. I have a capacitor of 1 microfarad and I have a resistor of 160 ohm. And I have the voltage source. So now let me put some probe and let me measure the input and the corresponding output. Let us observe the input and also let us observe the output. And I'm initially setting my frequency to around 400 hertz, a frequency in the pass band. And I'm also setting my input voltage as 3 volts. So let us run this circuit and let us observe the output. This is what we are having. Our input is the green. If you see our circuit, the green color probe corresponds to the input, and the blue color probe corresponds to the output. Of course, in this platform, the op amp power supply to the op amp is already given. So that is why I am not giving a supply because it's inbuilt. So now this is my input and this is my output. We have a passband gain. We have designed it for 3. We are getting again, this is around 2.9 and then I'm getting it around 8.2. So there is a gain, though not exactly equal to input frequency, to the cutoff frequency. So what is my cutoff frequency? Is say 1K. We have designed the system for a cutoff frequency of 1K. Let us see what happens to the output now. Now the output should actually become around 0.707 times the input. So let us check that. So now that we have a reduction in as compared to our earlier input. And if you see, this is my input around 3 volts and my output is around 6. So it's 0.707 times my passband gain, and so we have a reduction in the output. Now let us change my input frequency to a frequency much higher than the passband. The cutoff is 1 kilohertz. Now let me make my input frequency as say 10 kilohertz, so one decade below. And now let us see what is the output. So now you see, so this is a frequency we have set higher than our passband. So my input is the green color waveform. So now I have taken a frequency 1 decade below, or rather 1 decade further. So at 10 kilohertz, now my output has reduced. My initial input was around 3 volts. Now my output has become around 860.8 volt. So let me change the input further, and let us change the input frequency. Now let us say I make it as 100K, that is 2 decade below the cutoff. So let's run and see what is my output now. And see 2 decade below, what is the output we get? It's so low because we have gone 2 decade further, is 20 plus 20, almost 40 dB below, and so we see the complete attenuation at this frequency. That's around 3 volts. Now let us make my input amplitude as say 6 volts peak. So now let us see what happens. So now I'm setting my input to 6 volts, same 400 hertz in the passband, and let us see the output. The output in this case is getting clipped. This is because the op amp has a saturation voltage around 12 volts in this particular example, and hence I cannot get an output greater than the saturation voltage. So this is an input taken only to show that the output of any op amp cannot exceed its saturation voltage. So when we design filters with given specifications, we need to ensure that our input amplitude is not large enough to take to this state. So now let's take one more example. Now let us have the same, we have the same specifications. The cutoff frequency is 1 kilohertz, and let us say a second order Butterworth filter. And now I have selected it as the passband gain as a 1.586, and the reason we know, because the second order filter, the transfer function of our second order system, we know that H of S is given by ADC by S square plus 1.414 S plus 1, and we need to ensure that ADC is equal to 3 minus 1.414, and hence I am in the specifications itself, I am giving my specification as ADC is 1.586. In case we have any other DC gain given, we need to follow it up with one more circuit, an amplifier or an attenuator to meet the given gain specification. So now my resistor, since the cutoff frequency remains the same, my value of the resistor and capacitor remain the same. However, since now I have a gain of 1.586, so now once again let me set my RG. Let me set RG equal to 1 kilo ohm, and hence my RF. RF now becomes ADC minus 1, and that is 786 ohms. So let me set this, and let me have my second order circuit. Yes, so now this is our second order circuit where we have the resistor to the ground as 1K and my feedback resistor as 586 ohms. So this gives me a gain of 1.586. And I have both my capacitors of 1 microfarad, and my resistors are 160 ohm, because then this combination gives me a 3 dB cutoff of 1 kilohertz. I'm now putting selecting in my input frequency of 400 hertz and say 3 volts. Now this is some frequency in the pass band. So let us see the output. So in this case, we have a gain of 1.586, and hence these are our voltages. So these are my voltages. So this is the green I have my input around 3 volts and my output is around 4.6. So I have a gain of I have designed it for a gain of around 1.586. So that is what we are getting the gain in the pass band frequency. So when I add for a frequency of 400 hertz, my input peak is around 3 volts and my output. Let's select our input frequency to the cutoff frequency, that is 1 kilohertz. For an input frequency being 1 kilohertz, now let us see what is the output. I still have a gain. My input remains same, say around 2.3 volts, and my output is 3.33, because it now reduces to 0.707 times the passband gain, put at 10K, 10 kilohertz. Now 10 kilohertz happens to be in the stop band. So now let us see what is the output. So this you see is a second order system, so we are going to have 40 dB per decade attenuation, and hence now my output, if I look at my output, 40 dB down, just that one decade further. So now my peak is around 0.04 volts. Let us take up a third order high pass filter to give a cutoff of, say, we'll retain the cutoff as say 1 kilohertz. Of course, we can always change the components to give us any other this, and let us take the DC gain. Gain is say, say 6. So then in this case, I will have my first order system H1S and followed by another second order system H2S. And my first order system in this case will have, we know that the second order system, the transfer function is 1 by S squared plus S plus 1. And this will be say 1 by S plus 1, my prototype. And hence this can be designed to give me a gain of 3 minus 1. So that is going to give me a gain of 2. So I will set the second order system to give a gain of 2. And my first order system, since my overall gain has to be 6, I will set my first order system to give a gain of 6 by 2, and that is going to be 3. So I will set my first order system to give me a gain of 3 and the second order system to give a gain of 2, so that my overall gain is going to be 6. And my cutoff frequency is say, as remains as 1 kilohertz. So let us take this example. So so this is the circuit that we have rigged up for the high pass filter, third order Butterworth filter, to give us a cutoff frequency of 1 kilohertz. So our resistors are all of 160 ohm, as we have seen. When I select my capacitor to be 1 microfarad. The second order stage is designed to give a gain of 2. So that's a 1 plus 1 by 1, that is a 2. The first order stage has to give me a gain of 3. Since I want my overall gain to be 6, and hence we set this as 1 plus 2 by 1, that is a gain of 3, and the output of the first stage now becomes the input to the second stage. And let me put my probes to monitor one probe for the input, and let's put another probe for the output. And now let us see what the frequency that we have set is 10 kilohertz, and I'm giving a voltage of 2 volts. I think I will, yes, overall gain is 6. So let me set my input voltage even lower. Let us say 1.5 volts because I will be getting a gain of 6 and I do not want to go into saturation. This is a high pass filter. That is why I've set a frequency of around 10 kilohertz, so well within the pass band. So let us see what is the circuit. So this is in the pass band for a frequency of 10 kilohertz. If we look at the input, the input I'm having 1.5 volts is what I set my input peak as. And corresponding to that, I'm getting an output of 9, almost 9. So since we have set a pass band gain of 6. Now let us change the frequency. This is a high pass filter, so 10 kilohertz, this is what we got. So now let us go to the, let's change the frequency. Let us bring it to the cutoff frequency. So let me change my frequency as say the cutoff frequency, which is 1 kilohertz. And now let us see the output. Now there is going to be a reduction by, the gain now becomes 0.707 times the gain in the pass band. So this is what I have. Now my input is still around 1.5 and my output is around 6.4. So now let us reduce the frequency further, and let's give in my input frequency of in the stop band. So let's take our input frequency as say some 400 hertz. The third order filter, and now my input frequency is 400 hertz, well in the stop band, since I have my cutoff as 1 kilohertz. If I want to go one decade below, then I need to give 100 hertz. let me give 100 input frequency as 100 hertz and let us see what is the output. Yes, so the output, it's almost zero. It's almost zero. If I want to amplify it, or let us say minus 3 and say plus 3. And the output is almost zero for 1 decade below, because now we have used a third order filter. Third order filter, my input is around 1.5 volts and my output magnitude is almost 9 millivolts. It's around 9 millivolts. So we see it's a third order system. So our output is almost zero for one decade below the cutoff, because it's a high pass filter. So as another example, let's take a fourth order low pass filter to give us let us say our 3 dB cutoff FC is, let's say, 1 kilohertz, and gain. Again, we leave it open so that we can decide based on our transfer function. So now the fourth order transfer, it's a low pass filter. So again, I'm going to have two stages in cascade. Each will be of second order, say H1 and H2 of S. And let us say my input is. And we know here I have my one polynomial as S square plus 0.786 S plus 1. This is my H1S. And H2S is, say, S plus 1. So this is going to be 3 minus 1.84. 3 minus 1.85. And say 3 minus 0.765. 2.23 and 1.53. So this will have a gain of 3 minus 1.786, and that is going to be 2.23. This is going to be 3 minus 1.84, and that is 1.15 and 2.23. So these are our gains. And since my cutoff frequency is still 1 kilohertz, I retain the same. So my overall gain is going to be 2.23 into 1.15 and 1.15 into. If you are given any other gain, then we will be putting having one more block to give us this gain. So let us get a fourth order system with this input. The first one stage has a gain of 2.23, and the second stage to give a gain of 2.23. So this is 1 plus 1.23k, and this gives me the gain. All resistors are set as 160 ohm and C as 1 microfarad. This is a low pass filter, and let's run. We are giving the input as a sinusoidal signal. of peak voltage 2 and 800 hertz. It's a low pass filter within the pass band, so we expect the gain. The gain of this stage, the overall gain, we said has to be around 2.5 times the input in the pass band. So one stage of gain 2.23 and another of gain 1.15. So let us see, let us run and look at the output. So now there is nothing new, because this is something we are giving a sine wave in the pass band, and so we expect the gain to be large. So this is my input. My input has a voltage of around 2 volts and my output is around 5 volts. So we have a gain of around 2.5. And we are getting it. So fourth order stage with this gain, and if I increase the frequency, I know I'm going to get a attenuation. So let us just check. Let us change my input frequency. So to my cutoff is 1 kilohertz. So let me give an input of 10 kilohertz. So my output now will be 80 dB down. So it's going to be extremely low. So let's run and see the output. And this is it. So at this frequency, what happens is now my output is almost zero. So let's expand and see. See, this is because at one decade further, it's a fourth order system, and hence the output is almost zero. So now this is just a low pass filter with the fourth order. So now we will take up another input, and the purpose of connecting the circuit is not to repeat the same, but now we'll change our input source. Instead of having a sinusoidal source, we'll now have a square wave as my input. So now I have my input as a square wave, which gives me a clock input, which gives me 2 volts, 0 to 2 volts and 800 hertz. So now let us run the simulation and see what will be the output. And this is a very interesting output, because we have given a signal within the pass band. Our signal now, our input signal is a square wave of 800 hertz. And what is the output we are seeing? We are seeing the output as a sinusoidal signal of the same frequency. And why does this happen? This happens because of the Fourier representation of the square wave. So we know that a square wave. So what we did is, to the circuit, when we gave a sine wave, we got a sine wave as the output, and there was no change. And when I change the frequency, my amplitude of the output is going to change. Irrespective of the order of the filter, it's only the amplitude that is changing. Now, when I give my input as a square wave, I gave a square wave of frequency 800 hertz, and my cutoff frequency fc is 1 kilohertz, and I have a fourth order filter, so it's going to give me a beautiful attenuation beyond in the stop band. And in this case, my output is a sine wave, is the sine wave of my 800 hertz. The reason this happens is because this filter has a very good cutoff, and my square wave can be, is actually, we know from our Fourier series that even though I'm giving a square wave of 800 hertz, it is actually having sine waves of 800 hertz and odd harmonic. 1600 is not present, 83s are 2400 hertz, and the fifth harmonic 8 phi's are 4 kilohertz. These are the harmonics which are present in my input square wave, and these two are getting filtered out. The 2.4k and the 4k are getting filtered out, and all higher harmonics are getting filtered, and what we are seeing is only the 800 hertz. So even though I give a square wave of 800 hertz within the passband, I get to see only the 800 hertz sine wave, and this is because of our Fourier knowledge. We are able to appreciate this result. So now what happens if I want to if I permit, now let us say I change my input frequency. I continue to give a square wave to this fourth order filter, but now let us say I make my input frequency as say around 300 hertz. Now if I make my input frequency as 300 hertz, what happens is my first harmonic that is 300 hertz, a square wave of 300 hertz will have odd harmonics. 300, 900 hertz, it's not going to have 600, 9, 3, 5, 3 is 15. So this third harmonic, the first harmonic passes through, and 900 hertz component is going to pass through the filter. And this output from our theory of Fourier series should give me an output like this. And let us see whether we get this output. Of course, it's not going to be an ideal filter, because I will have these component, the 1500 component also with some reduced attenuation being present in my output. Similarly, 7 3s are 21, so 2100 hertz also will be present with the reduced attenuation. So let us see the output for my input now being changed to. Say I have the same 2 volts. Instead of 800 hertz, let me make my input frequency to say 300 hertz. So now my first harmonic and the third harmonic both should get through, and let us see what's the output. This is what we see. This is what we see. So we are not seeing exactly, because we have other harmonics also being passed partially, but very similar. We have a gain because the passband signals and passband frequency have a gain, and what this shows that the square wave has odd harmonics present. This is the output that we are seeing. Now what if I reduce my input frequency further, and when do I have a good representation? My square wave, I want it to come out as a square wave and not as in this distorted manner. So then I should have at least 10 or 15 harmonics present. So my cutoff frequency is designed for 1 kilohertz. So if I want my square wave to come out as a square wave, I should allow at least around say 15 harmonics to get through. So my input frequency I need to reduce further. So let me make my input frequency as say 50 hertz. So I'm making my input frequency a very small value. I mean 50 hertz, then my cutoff is 1 kilohertz. So now in according to my Fourier knowledge, because most of the harmonics are getting passed through now, my output in this case should now be a square wave. Yes. And we see it's a good representation of the square wave. And again, we have another interesting observation. One, a square wave has come out as a square wave, but because of the finite truncation, we know when we truncate truncate a Fourier series through up to a finite value, we will have the Gibbs phenomenon, and that is why we have a small overshoot and an undershoot, because we have truncated, but the frequency is same, and we got a square wave as a square wave with the Gibbs phenomenon being present. We have also observed this Gibbs phenomenon when we were designing the rectangular window function and truncating the Fourier series. So whenever I truncate the Fourier series, unless I have the complete all pass frequency, no matter how many components I'm going to add, this Gibbs phenomenon is always present, and it's very interesting to see this. And this we can see only when we have higher order order filter. We have just taken a fourth order filter. If I go further, I will have even a better representation of my square wave. As another example of as an application of filters, let us consider sampling. Let us consider we have a sinusoidal signal x of t, and then I give it to a transistor. I will consider a transistor as a switch. And here I give my signal x of t, the sinusoidal signal. At the base, I'm going to give a square wave or sampling frequency fs. This is my signal x of t, and I take my output at the emitter. And this I'm going to here I will be able to see a sample signal. So I'll perform sampling, and we know that when I do sampling, I can recover my message from the samples. So I'm having a sample signal here, xs of t. And next, I'm going to take this signal xs of t of the signal, and let me pass it through a low pass filter. And my output of my signal should give back my signal x of t, of course, with some change in amplitude, but no change in frequency. So this for this low pass filter, let's consider our fourth order Butterworth filter that we have just designed. So we have a fourth order Butterworth filter with a cutoff frequency of fc equal to 1 kilohertz. With this as low pass filter, and I'm going to have my circuit to do sampling. I perform sampling. So we have already seen in the initial modules that the transistor be my sample signal excess of t. Now this excess of t, I pass it through a low pass filter. For low pass filter, we'll keep the same fourth order Butterworth filter with the cutoff of 1 kilohertz. And let us see what is the output. And because I'm passing it through the low pass filter, my output should give back my signal x of t, which should, provided it is of a frequency within the pass band. So since my cutoff frequency is 1 kilohertz, let me choose some signal x of t, which is within the pass band, say, and then let us see the output. So let's go to our circuit. So here what I have is I have my whole Butterworth filter, whatever was designed, I have not changed it at all. I have it as such. And then now here I have my transistor with the three resistors connected this function has a switch. For my sampling, I'm going to use a square wave of some high frequency, say 8 kilohertz, some high frequency, 8 kilohertz. And this I have right now set it to a 50% duty cycle. Of course, I need to reduce the duty cycle if I want to truly observe sampling. And for my message or my low frequency signal, I'm setting a signal of 400 hertz, some frequency within the pass band, and 3 volts. So now let us see the signal and the sample signal to start. So we have set, so let us try to observe the signal and the sample signal. I'm not yet connected to the filter. So let's see the output. This is the output. So what we have is, we have the sine wave. And then we have the we are having a square wave of some high frequency, and so we are having the sampled output. So this blue waveform is my sampled output. So let's go back to our circuit. Let's give this sampled output as the input to the next stage. I'm going to my low pass filter that we had designed. So I'm going to give this as my input. So now I have my sampled output. This sampled output I'm giving to the filter, and let me see the output. So the output is going to be in the blue color font, and my input is my green color waveform. So all that I have is, in the first stage I have done sampling, and then I'm giving it to my fourth order Butterworth filter, low pass Butterworth filter, with a cutoff of 1 kilohertz. So let's run and see what is the output. This is our output, which what is that? The input was the green color font and the blue color font is our output. See, we have our sine wave recovered perfectly because we have passed it through a good filter, a filter with a good cutoff, and we have also taken a reasonably high sampling frequency, and that's the reason we are able to see a very good recovery of our signal. So let us see now what happens if I reduce my, because using square wave of duty cycle 50% is not good, and we're actually looking at ideal almost zero impulses. So let's reduce the duty cycle of my square wave. Now, because the duty cycle reduces, my strength of my output should reduce. So let me make my duty cycle as a 20%. I'm not changing the frequencies, but I'm still trying to observe the output. So let us see what happens to the output. Now I have just reduced the duty cycle, all other parameters remaining same. And what do we find now? As compared to the earlier case, we still have the recovery. We have the recovery. Only thing is the strength has reduced because the duty cycle has reduced. Now let me change the sampling. Let me change the frequency of my sampling, and let us see what is the impact. So now what I will do is I will now reduce my sampling frequency. But let me go back to 50% duty cycle, because then I have a good strength of my recovered signal. And let me now make my instead of a for a 400 hertz signal, I have used an 8 kilohertz sampling frequency. It's quite high. So let me just reduce my sampling frequency. Let us say I make it to 4 kilohertz, and let us see whether we are able to have a reasonable recovery of our sample signal. We still have now what we did is we have, instead of having an 8 kilohertz sampling frequency, I have now made it to 4 kilohertz. It's a fourth order filter, and I still have a good recovery. Of course, I set my duty cycle of my square wave to 50%. So now let me further reduce my frequency and see whether I can still have a recovery of my message. So now I have reduced my sampling frequency to 2 kilohertz, and let us now see the output. And so there is distortion. There is a distortion. So with 2 kilohertz, I'm not able to get a good recovery. So since my cutoff frequency of my filter is 1 kilohertz, let me set my message to some frequency within the pass band, say 800 hertz, and let me run it now. So my message, I have made it to 800 hertz and my sampling frequency to 2 kilohertz, and let us look at the output. There is distortion. So for my message of 800 hertz, even though I have a fourth order filter, I'm not able to get a reasonable output. So let's increase the sampling frequency further and see. Say I make it as 3 kilohertz. I have a good recovery for a 3 kilohertz for the eye, human eye. It appears a good sine wave. So we are all, through this example, we have tried to prove the sampling theorem as well. So when I have a signal in the pass band, and if I use a good high frequency for sampling, I'm able to get back my message from the sample signal. So this was another example to show that we can recover the message from the we could recover the message from the samples, from its samples, and for when we have used a fourth order filter. Of course, we will not be able to verify the sampling limit that is twice FM, but some frequency larger than twice. So for 800 Hertz with the 3 kilohertz of sampling frequency, we are able to see a reasonable recovered signal. So now if I make my sampling frequency even higher, I'm going to get a much better output. So instead of so this is 800 Hertz with, so any frequency 800 Hertz or what, any frequency within the pass band of our filter and some reasonable high frequency. So for an 800 Hertz message and 4 kilohertz as my sampling frequency, we have a beautiful recovery of our signal from the samples. So this was another example. So to summarize, we have seen how to design Butterworth filters for any given order, maybe any order, and we also saw how to design a low pass or a high pass filter. And as specific examples, just for fun. We gave square wave as input to the low pass filter, and then we saw the output, and we were able to appreciate the Fourier series representation, and we could also observe the Gibbs phenomenon. Another example we took was on the sampling. On sampling, we performed sampling and we tried to recover the message, the signal from the samples, and that has also worked. And we used, for these two examples, we used the fourth order Butterworth filter. Of course, in all our examples, we have set our cutoff frequency to 1 kHz purely for convenience. And we know the design equation. So given any other frequency specifications or order, we are capable of implementing the design. In the next module, we will take up